everyone. We are just days away from Snap's first earnings report as a public company, and here to give us a preview is Fred McClimans, partner at Samadhi Partners and contributor for Seeking Alpha. Fred, as always, it is good to see you, and we want to kick off with Snap. What are you expecting out of this first earnings call from the company?
Well, you know, this certainly is a very anticipated first call, and it comes at a very interesting time because from a cyclic perspective, you know, this industry typically has a dip right about now as it starts to go into the full calendar year. And we've certainly seen that a bit with Facebook and Twitter that have kind of, I think, tempered expectations a bit for Snap. But in terms of Snap itself, my take right now is we're probably likely to see a modest increase in daily average users, maybe a 3 to 4% increase there. You know, that would be in line with sort of the overall hype and excitement of the IPO. But from a revenue perspective, I think they're likely to underperform a little bit against consensus.
Right, and we know that the consensus analyst expectations game is something that is played every quarter with the companies, with analysts, with media alike. What happens if they miss the expectations? We're looking at EPS loss of 19 cents a share, revenue of $158 million for this past quarter. So this is something that analysts have come up with based on what the company has told them and based on their own modeling, and then we report on it. But if they do miss, which is what you're expecting, it seems like, what does that mean for the company and for their first earnings report?
Well, you know, you're right that you know, getting this missed target accurate, it's a bit of an educated guess here. I mean, we run five different scenarios for every company in our portfolio, and you know, right now when I look at what Snap is doing, I think consensus is a bit high. But remember too, this is very early on in Snap's public life, even in Snap's corporate life. You know, people that are behind Snap right now are behind it because they see some significant long-term value. So, you know, even with a slight miss here, I don't see this being something that would push, you know, Snap to the wayside or damage it in any significant way. As long as they're doing reasonably well, the people that are big on Snap, they'll continue to look for the positives moving forward here. And there is a lot of potential for Snap, you know, once they can start to really, you know, settle things down and figure out what this competitive landscape, you know, with, you know, Twitter, Facebook, and everybody that's now jumping into video is really going to look like.
Fred, of course, you mentioned some of the key metrics that you're going to be watching for there. I think some people, too, a little still in the dark or just uncertain as to what the strategy is here. How is it going to differentiate itself from Facebook when we know it is a tiny fraction of Facebook? And so when it comes to any commentary that we might get, of course, we don't know whether or not Spiegel's actually going to be on the call, but beyond just some of those key metrics, I mean, what sort of rhetoric, what sort of needle threading are you going to be looking for here to gain some sort of perspective as to, I guess, the longevity or maybe what is next from a strategy standpoint for the company?
Well, you know, so Snap has a couple of different components. You know, right now Snapchat is the dominant force there, but we see, you know, the Snapticals and other hardware lines, you know, touching onto AR and VR as ultimately being very important plays for Snapchat and for Snap as a corporate company. So I'm definitely going to be looking for that. What are they doing? What are they investing in? When do they think they can actually really start to drive some material you know, results, or at least start to impact the marketplace? We need to see some type of improvement in the ARPU number, the average revenue per user. Right now, Snap you know, is woefully behind Facebook, almost an order of magnitude behind, and they really need to demonstrate that they can bring that up a bit. And that kind of leads me to sort of the third area. I want to see what they're doing with video to be a bit more aggressive than Facebook is, because Facebook and Twitter both right now are starting to line up. You know, if they were playing Texas Hold'em, it would be almost an all-in play on video. So I want to get a little bit of more comfortable feel that Snap is actually going to be able to bring the additional video streams in, and they are so far, but then more importantly, monetize those. That's the real key.
Well, from what we've heard, it seems like they will do a rev share with the content publishers. I think they'll give a 50-50 cut if they are able to sell it, and if they don't sell it, and the content publishers sell it, that they would get a 30% cut. So is that not aggressive enough for you, or do you look for more on the strategy side about what the content will be, because unlike Facebook, they're not paying for these up front. They're giving the rev share for a reason, because maybe they think it's not a good use of their cash to be able to just pay for content up front.
Well, you know, I don't think Snap is in a position right now where they need to either, upfront pay or really dive into the heavy development of original programming content, like an Amazon or a Facebook is now suggesting it's going to do. I think they're in a very different position there.
Okay,
but it's important, though. There are any number of different models for how to monetize video. We just need to see that they have one that's actually going to work.
Speaking of video there, Fred, it's an easy transition or natural transition into Facebook. And, of course, the announcements, the big story in Business Insider, that it is getting ready to unveil this TV-like package on the platform with longer-form content, scripted, high-quality shows, as well as some of the shorter content as well. The shorter content has already been on Facebook for a long time. But ramping up this overall TV experience it's trying to do, what do you make of that? How do you think Facebook is going about this when it comes to competition out there? We know Snap's trying to do the same thing in its own right, YouTube making a big announcement at its own new fronts, and then obviously Amazon as well.
Video is one of those really interesting aspects of content that has people really starting to think, is video content, is it an application, a product, or is it really just a feature of a larger product? And if you look at the way content has been pushed out there in the past, for many years, video was the entire product. We consumed it through TV, we consumed it on our mobiles, but it was a product. Very rapidly, it's becoming a feature. We see that with Facebook, we see it with Twitter, we see it with Amazon, that is now starting to bring other content providers that could have been standalone in through their channels as well. So for Facebook, I think they need to be in this particular space. They need to figure it out. But they do have some challenges. Long-form original programming, that's difficult to monetize with advertising these days. That's typically something that you would expect people to subscribe to. And people do seem willing to pay for that high-end quality product up front, or at least on a monthly subscription basis. I think the shorter video, that's where they can really target advertising, but they don't yet have a channel strategy. It's not very easy to use the Facebook app to kind of flip through channels, and that's where I think their tab approach might be the right approach for them here.
All right, and we know that they've launched an Apple TV app, so that if you do want to watch videos from Facebook, you can do it on a very big screen in your home if you'd like. I think my biggest question is, what are the shows going to look like? I mean, a lot of them sound, for Snapchat, for example, sound like they'll be spin-offs of existing things that are already on TV to try to bring some of those audiences onto the mobile. But creating something from scratch and trying to build an audience from scratch as a result seems like a very difficult thing that none of these companies are equipped for, because they have started out as platforms and not as content creators.
That's a good point there. And the differences in approach are very notable. With Snap, they are taking existing content streams and they're putting sort of a Snapchat filter onto that content, tailoring it and developing it a bit to be a bit more tuned for their particular audience. Facebook, they've got a very different demographic, a much larger demographic, a much broader demographic. And for them, I think the approach of really targeting some of the big name stars, high-end production values, high-end writing teams, that's probably the best approach for them there. But it is a challenge because everybody's trying to create that high-end content. And from what we see, Facebook really is going after that kind of a blended mix, a number of short, weekly episodic type events, and then larger extended, what they call high quality, star production value, type of content. So they have the ability to pull that off. I'm not sure that Snap could do that at this particular point.
Fred, one thing that keeps coming up here in my head is that it was not too long ago that Facebook warned everyone during an earnings call or in regards to earnings that advertising revenue, they shouldn't expect, people and investors shouldn't expect the same pace of advertising growth to continue down the road. I mean, if we get this new TV package unveiled mid-June, like these reports are saying, to me, this is ripe with advertising, right? We're not expecting some sort of subscription service to debut from Facebook. It's all about the advertising. And so how much advertising potential when it comes to revenues do you think there is for Facebook here?
I think we're talking about two aspects of the same issue. The ad inventory, the number of places that Facebook can put an ad onto their existing content, it is limited. And by shifting to video, you open up a whole new channel of content and potentially drive a lot more stickiness. You know, when you're watching video, if it's a 10-minute video and it's engaging, you'll stick around for the full 10 minutes or maybe the full 20 or 30 minutes. So that does open up sort of a greenfield opportunity for Facebook, Twitter, and potentially Snap to kind of move into this space to start to pull advertising dollars away from traditional video providers, you know, the traditional, you know, ABC, NBC, CBSs of the world. So I think it is a good move, and I think what you're seeing here is a bit of Facebook maneuvering around that earlier ad revenue shortfall that they were anticipating.
All right, Fred McClimans, partner at Samadhi Partners and contributor for Seeking Alpha. Thank you for joining us, as always.
Thanks, Fred.
Thank you.